sorry for the slight delay in getting started. We've had to get a few people through when we opened the doors at 12. And thank you all for coming to State of the Nation. Exchanges on Homelessness, we've been planning this for 18 months. And the idea behind the weekend is to create lots of different events, lots of different activities, which really offer a snapshot of what's happening in people's lives, on the streets, in hostels, day centres, and other areas where homelessness is in 2017. And that was really a response to this space that we have here, an amazing opportunity and a platform. And the reason behind these talks is that we wanted to sort of bring in people who have a different perspective, who have something interesting to say about where we are. And we offered them State of the Nation as a provocation. That was our brief to all the speakers. And really, really grateful to everyone who is speaking today and responding to this rather vague thing that we've thrown out there. Homelessness has been rising for the last 7 years, so I'm all sure that people are going to have some very, very interesting things to say. We've broken the day up into two sessions, starting from 12 to 2, and then 2:30 to 4:30. And our host for the day is Shardine Taylor-Stone. Jess, do you want to say a few words at all?
I just wanted to, just to echo. So I'm Jess Turtle, one of the co-founders of the Museum of Homelessness. This is Matt, the other co-founder. I don't know if you introduced yourself.
I always forget.
But we're so delighted that you've all come to join in these conversations. They're really important to have. And I think one of the things just to say about the Museum of Homelessness is that it's, although Matt and I initially had the idea for a Museum of Homelessness, since the very beginning, we've been working with a mixed group of people. Some people bring expertise in the creative industries, and some people bring expertise in the lived experience of homelessness. All of our decisions are made together. And when we brought the group up to this space and said, what do you want to do with it? They said, there's no question that it's got to be a call to action. So that's what the weekend is, around the challenges that people are facing. And I think we've got some people attending for the talks from Manchester today. Are you guys here yet? Yes, which is amazing. Thank you so much for traveling all the way down. We were so delighted when we got the email to say that you were coming. So it means a lot to us that people would come to join in from the north. So that's fantastic. Not much more to say apart from...
Well, I was beginning my introduction to Shardine. So Shardine is an activist, artist and a cultural producer. And I first became aware of her when I learned that she was coordinating all of the punk London celebrations for 2016. She's really charged up about the issues. I think she's going to make a fantastic host. She's going to take questions from the floor. Each of our speakers will speak for about 10 minutes, but I'll let Shardine kind of handle that side of things. We're really grateful. And the first session, we're going to have David Tovey, Matt Peacock, Beth Knowles, James Murray, the Deputy Mayor for Housing, and Charlotte Ann Scarlett from Crack and Cider. So I'll hand over to Shardine now to get things going. Shardine, I hope I haven't said some of the things you wanted to say.
Hello. Hi, just to, so I am Shardine Taylor-Stone, and just as Matt was saying, I do quite a few other things. I'm a feminist activist particularly, and I've done some issues around housing. I live in Brixton Housing Co-op, and I also did Reclaim Brixton, which was the start of a fight against gentrification in my area. So I don't want to hang around too long. As Matt said, I feel very strongly about these issues. I've had experiences of homelessness myself growing up in a council housing and social housing. I'm sure some people have had those experiences as well. So I don't want to make it too much about me. So I'm going to introduce David. Now, David is a formerly homeless artist and activist. He is the founder of the One Festival of Homeless Arts, which is held annually at the Diorama Art Studio. David's primary medium is photography, but he works in many different media, including painting and performance making. His Soldier's Story installation is part of this weekend at Tay Exchange, which you can see out there, and he'll be bringing his third edition of the Man on Bench fashion show to the floor tomorrow at 2:30. So can you give your round of applause to David, please?
Afternoon all. Can you all hear me okay, yeah?
Right,
I'm not gonna talk about everything. I'm just gonna take you back to 4 years ago, a time of my life where things were going a bit rough, and this is why I do what I do now. So 4 years ago, back in the October of 2013, I was living on the streets of London, living in my car. I had really bad addiction problems, mental health problems, and I was going through colon cancer at the time. I never used any of the soup kitchens or anything like that when I was living on the streets, so I sort of kept it to myself. No one really knew that I was homeless. So I used to eat out of bins and a few delis, which used to throw away their food at the end of the night. But in October, my health started to really deteriorate, and I started to lose horrendous amounts of weight. I was defecating over myself, vomiting over myself, and it just got to a stage that it was either I get off the streets or I end my own life. So I made the decision one night, I was on Isledon Road in Islington, to end my own life. And so I went into a park which was locked, it was late night. And I went to a park bench, and it's, I only found this out recently, it was right next to a kid's play area. And I was in quite a state, you can imagine, like, you know, my mental state wasn't really to what it is today. I pulled out a syringe of crystal meth, 2 grams of crystal meth, and decided that, yep, this is the perfect place to die and the perfect time. You know, I was so broken that I couldn't see the next day. And so even though I was broken, my mental state was completely over the place, I was in sound mind that this was what I was gonna do. So as I sat there, I was crying my eyes out. And I remember, all I remember was rocking on this park bench as I pulled this syringe out. And as I was sticking it into my arm, suddenly I heard this voice. And this guy was like, "What are you doing? Can I help you?" For me, that was probably one of the nicest voices I'd ever heard, because after 6 months of going through the hell that I'd been through, he was the first person to actually ask me what was wrong, if I needed help. He took the syringe and sat there with me, asking me, talking to me, you know, finding out my story, why I was trying to kill myself. And I admit, I completely broke down with him. I was in sheds of tears. I couldn't talk, I couldn't look at him in the face. He was a park enforcement officer, and I met him last year because I wanted to thank him for taking a chance on me. He is called Gavin, so I found out. I've met him twice in my life, both on the same park bench. One at a bad time of my life and one at a really good point of my life. And I had the joy to meet this guy and say to him, to ask him why he stopped. Why he made that effort, you know, because so many people, as we know, walk past homeless people every single day of the week. He didn't. You know, he could have thought I was just some addict just having another hit. But he didn't. He knew that it was something not quite there. So I got to meet him, and I got to say to him, like, not only did you save my life, you actually gave me a new life. You know, you gave me a purpose to do what I do now. So I'm a great believer in second chances. You know, I believe in giving the voiceless a voice, to take somebody who's at their lowest point and helping them to create something great. This is why my fashion show especially is called Man on Bench. Because it's named after Gavin. And it only takes one person to change someone's life for the better. One person. Thank you.
Thank you. We'll be after the first next two speakers. We're going to have a short break so people can ask questions and stuff like that. Because we don't have much time. If you can, maybe whilst listening, start thinking about what questions you might want to ask, so then we can like rapidly go through it and have teas and coffees and stuff. So next, I'm going to introduce Matt Peacock. If I can just get your bio up. Here we are. It's modern technology. I always keep saying I should write everything down, but I'm a millennial, so sorry. So, introducing Matt Peacock. Matt is the director of With One Voice, an artistic director at Streetwise Opera, and will present on the international perspective for homelessness and with work of this new international movement for arts and homelessness. So could you give your round of applause for Matt, please?
Thanks very much, and to begin with, congratulations to Matt and Jess for putting this together. It's a really important weekend, so well done for them. I know it's been a huge amount of work. Streetwise Opera is celebrating 15 years this year. Woo! Thanks. Yeah. Cheer of one. Good. Let's go. We get back to the beginning. Sorry. Thanks. And we're a music charity that works with people who've experienced homelessness, running programs all around England. And With One Voice is a very new international arts and homelessness movement, connecting organizations that work with arts and people with a lived experience of homelessness all around the world, all art forms, all countries. I'm going to start off with a bit of a provocation. We were asked to do provocations, and here's one. I've always maintained that social welfare is like a jigsaw puzzle. It's a jigsaw of many elements that go towards solving or supporting one particular issue. In terms of homelessness, some of these can be healthcare, food and shelter, training, jobs, education, tenancy support, recovery, housing. And as we know, that's not the full story. If you've experienced homelessness, what about dignity and visibility and self-esteem and pride and having an opportunity to inhabit a different kind of identity that's not about problems but about achievements? And social inclusion and building bridges for people back into society. And in short, giving people the permission to believe in themselves. So this is the ta-da moment. Arts and creativity. This does all those things. And my provocation is that we should think more about social welfare and about homelessness in terms of a jigsaw of many different elements coming together, not as a hierarchy where the arts, like Maslow's theory, where the arts is seen to be kind of, you know, there if we have everything else in place, but a fundamental piece of the jigsaw. So I'm going to give you a bit of a perspective about international arts and homelessness. This is what With One Voice is trying to do, to connect arts and homeless sector, to strengthen existing projects around the world, inspire new activity, increase awareness of the importance of arts and homelessness, and to influence policy. And this is the Berlin Street Choir, the Strasschor. It all started in London 2012 at the Cultural Olympiad, where we got together quite a lot of the UK sector. There were 34 organisations in arts and homelessness performing that day, 300 performers had experienced homelessness. That was about the first time that the sector had got together properly like that, and it kind of galvanised and supported and gave encouragement to all of us. We're all terrified every single day when we run these projects, and coming together makes us all stronger. We've begun by kind of mapping the sector. This is our website, and at the bottom you can see a map. And so far we've found about 200 arts and homelessness organisations around the world. A third of them, interestingly, are in the UK, although we are in the UK, so we found those arguably first. But also like a third are in North America, and we've been working in Japan very recently, kind of combed the sector, and there's only about six there. So UK has got quite a lot. So now we're going to go on a journey through five continents to discover some bits of arts and homelessness and also some policy that we're quite interested in. So starting off in Europe, this is the rather brilliant Pacte Parisien, a five-year program that the mayor of Paris is running at the moment. And in each arrondissement, in each borough, the mayor and the cultural office has put together cultural spaces, galleries and museums and the like, with homeless centres and social welfare centres, every single borough, and they're matched together. Amazing project. Also in Europe, Sondereux, what could you say about them? They're a pop band, a choir, a training ground for music leaders, a brilliant organisation. Over the pond to America, and this week, Beth, who you're going to hear about a bit later, has just published for With One Voice a North America Arts and Homelessness Review, which is on our website, which you'll see at the end. So this is the Theatre of the Press in New York City, which works in forum theatre like Cardboard Citizens and all the Theatre of the Press around the world. They've got a brilliant legislative theatre methodology where you watch, then you act, and then you vote on social issues. And they do a festival every year. Seattle Path with Art, who use the arts to connect individuals and individuals to self, and self to community, and then the community into society. It's an absolutely brilliant program that's working all around Seattle with quite a lot of the main arts institutions, including the Seattle Symphony Orchestra. Big cheer for Redline Services, and if Billy from Redline Services in Chicago could put your hand up, he's here over from Chicago, so do chat to him afterwards about his work. It's awesome. I hope I do well in describing it, but they do a lot of work in enacting solutions through the arts, and they've just had an art project in a gallery which has had an element of housing first. So as part of the art project, they've housed two homeless people. And if you think about the whole of Chicago has housed 70 people out of 100,000 homeless people, this is a great project. Moving up to Canada, we have ATSA in Montreal. And Montreal boasts 11 projects, one of the biggest sectors in the whole world as a city. And this is an arts and homelessness festival called Entente d'une Soupe, where they get the public and homeless people together to share a meal and then discuss homelessness issues through that. And then Execo, and I cropped this photo rather badly, so they're not just sharing a cigarette there. This is actually a street art project. And Execo have this methodology where they have a theory of equality of intellect, where they encourage cultural spaces to open their doors to everyone. And that program has become quite famous all over Canada. Down to South America, where we've been working for the last quite a few years, With Woven Voice works with a number of organizations who are here on exchanges, including Cafe Art and the Homelessness Charter. We've set up six choirs, which are based on one choir so far. And this led up to the Cultural Olympiad in Rio last July, where a number of organizations from around the world got together. My next two provocations are about Brazil. On the one hand, they have a system in every single state called the Movimento População de Rua, the movement of the population of the street. So in every city, homeless people have a direct legislative link to government, to local government. So they have a right to speak to the government officers who are organising homelessness. It's about the only method in existence, apart from Manchester, who've taken up the baton of that challenge. So my provocation is that every city should have a way of the city councillors having a direct link to homeless people, and that being written in law. The other thing that Brazil does amazingly well is talk about arts in terms of human rights. So you go to Brazil and you don't have to lobby any of the city councillors or the federal government. They already get it. They already get the technology of the arts being incredibly important for social welfare, for fighting conflict in the favelas and in the drug wars. If we started talking about arts as a human right in the Charter of Human Rights, which is another thing enshrined in law, I think that would help many situations around the world. Over to the Pacific, in Japan, we have Sokarisa, who are a dance organization working in parks around Tokyo, running workshops every week with rough sleepers who live in the parks. And then we have Kokorum in Osaka in Japan, who started out as a cafe and now have a university of arts for homeless people in Osaka, where they have a range of activities, rather like Crisis Skylight do in this country. Gamelan, calligraphy, visual arts, every single week. It's a brilliant program. Down to Africa, and way out in Sierra Leone in Africa, uses music and film to help young homeless people. And Michael Chandler from Cardboard Citizens is a trustee of this, so do ask him if you see him. And finally, Australia. We have the Choir of Hard Knocks, which became very famous because a TV program was made out of them on the first day of rehearsals when they started in 2008. And they do sell out gigs at the Sydney Opera House. And they've started a program again like Crisis Skylight, lots of different activities through the week. I'd be killed by all of my colleagues at Streetwise Opera if I didn't mention this, which is our last show, The Passion, which was in Manchester, which was broadcast on BBC4 last year. It's coming back online this month. It's been seen by 140,000 people so far, and we hope that you'll all see it free on BBC Online. And this is my final slide, which is With One Voice is commissioning two papers this year, one on cultural spaces and homelessness strategy. So around the world, cultural spaces, libraries, galleries, arts venues, all want to be very welcoming. Most of them are free to walk in. Homeless people tend to use cultural spaces everywhere. But there is no joined up strategy. There's no linking of any of these ways of working. Some organizations do it brilliantly. South Bank Centre have a homelessness strategy, but that's about the only one we've come across. And so we're going to write a paper that brings together some case studies of how buildings are working with people with a lived experience of homelessness, and maybe share some guidelines. And that will be launched at a summit of arts and homelessness that we're going to launch in Manchester next year. And then we're going to also do a literature review of case studies of literature all about arts and homelessness around the world. And one final plug, which is Cafe Art are doing an international arts exhibition, which is on now, right? Now. Great. Whereabouts? Diorama Arts. Fabulous. Thank you very much.
Okay, now moving on to our last speaker for this part of the first session, and then we'll have a break, and then it's at 2 o'clock actually, where we're going to have sandwiches are going to come in and teas and coffees and stuff. So I'd like to introduce Councillor Beth Knowles. So Beth Knowles is a politician and has worked in international development for a variety of NGOs and trade unions, including Oxfam, the British Red Cross, and Unison. She became a councillor for Manchester City Centre in May 2014, focusing on issues surrounding homelessness, arts and culture, and improving public realm within the city. She will discuss the work of the Manchester Homeless Charter, which is working to end homelessness in the city by 2020. Beth.
Okay. And in true Manchester Homelessness Partnership style, very serendipitously and a little bit last minute, and everybody wants to be involved and should be involved. There are a great crowd from Manchester over as well, so I'm going to take up about 5 or 6 minutes and run through the stuff with the charter as quickly as possible, and then Colette from Women's Voices is here also, and John, who's been part of our arts group and is co-chair of Inspiring Change. I'm sure he'll talk you through that a bit more. But the floor is open to everybody, I was told, so they're going to talk you through minus the slides. That's okay with everybody. So the Manchester Homelessness Partnership came out of Brazil and a little bit of Leeds thrown in for good measure. So Manchester likes to be a little arrogant and likes to think it does stuff first. But as a Scouser by heritage, I know that's not entirely true. And we're very, very proud of the Manchester Homelessness Partnership, but it was inspiration from other places that enabled it to happen. So Matt gave a kind of brief introduction to the National Movement for the Street Population. Being able to see people taking part in their democracy and shaping their own space through social movements was a kind of pivotal moment in my life, and Dave as well, who's sat in the audience, who I went over to Brazil with. So being able to see a social movement coming into city councils and shaping policy for people who've been shoved out in Manchester was extremely powerful. And we thought, on the back of a napkin in Heathrow, that we could do just as well, if not better, in Manchester. So we came back. There was, in that picture, there's Amanda Croom, who set up and runs the Booth Centre, which is one of the best, if not the best, integrated arts and homelessness centres in the country. There's Dave and myself and Paul Connery, who went from Manchester. So it was a good combination of policy, politician, which is me, although I like to pretend it's not sometimes, and someone with experience of homelessness, and then the voluntary sector in the city. So it was that combination that was essential, and at the right time as well in the city, when we had... there's been a 600% increase in rough sleeping in the past 6 years. I'll let you all decide what happened 6 years ago in 2010 and leave the rest of that. I'm a Labour politician and I'm going to keep politics out of it, but I'll let you think about what happened in 2010. So these are the two most important things about the partnership, are these things, which are the people involved and the values and ethos with which they're involved with. So the partnership is... its main aim is to end homelessness. That's a grand aim, but there's no point having one unless it is grand, I don't think. And it's a partnership of all of the civil, public, business institutions in the city, cultural institutions in the city council, the voluntary sector, and most importantly, people with lived experience of homelessness who've been through the services. And our aim is to redesign them and make them work for people in the way that they would have liked them to originally. Amazingly, the council said yes when I came back to them with a notepad. And me and Dave and Paul and Amanda sat in a meeting with a very inspired council officer. So if you can find an inspired council officer, dig them out and keep them close, because they want to work with you, is what we found. Nobody wants to see people rough sleeping. Nobody wants to see people in temporary accommodation that's substandard. So that's find people you can work with is my intervention. I think my proposal for today is to find the partnership that you can work with. None of this works with one person or even really three or four. It needs a whole city to come together, and you need the right time and place, and I think that is now as well. So, and co-production, so meaningful involvement, not tokenism, is really important. So the charter is what underpins the partnership. So the charter's the vision, which is to put an end to homelessness in Manchester, and the set of values that we spent a really long time co-producing. So Jez Green, who can't be here today, facilitated the charter. He met with nearly 100 people with experience of homelessness, almost every homeless organisation in the city council, businesses, activists, and drew together these values, which are... we're then all supposed to take action to implement as well. So people can pledge online to take action, which they can do on this website, but they can also find how to help people they might see on the streets, or how to be able to donate their time or their skills. So there's a conduit, no matter where you sit and what your space is in the city, to be able to be involved, which is really important to all of us. And I'll just glide through this gradually. Big Change is an alternative giving scheme that we have in Manchester. So there's every element of the charity. So there's taking action so people can pledge, but there's no point in them just pledging to say, I'll give you £1,000 or I'll give somebody an employment opportunity. Everybody sits underneath an action group in the charter. So there's 10 of them at the moment, but that ebbs and flows with what action needs to be taken. And they were set up based on what people told us needed to change. So I'll glide through. So this is one of them. Bear this in mind. Alternative giving. That was a very nice launch event. Streetwise Opera made an appearance. And then these are the action groups. So this is the really important bit. So whether people are presenting at the town hall and have had a bad experience, that goes through one group. There's emergency accommodation. There are redesigning women's direct access. There's mental health provision. There's employment. And there's substandard temporary accommodation. The arts and heritage has an important place in the charter as well. So the whole point of that is for people to spend as long as it takes to co-produce the outcomes from those groups and to work together to achieve them. They're all co-chaired, nobody's in control and nobody's in charge. The council's pledge that I whizzed past really quickly is probably one of the most important, which is they've pledged for the rest of forever, as far as I'm concerned, to co-produce all of their homelessness services. And it's worked so well in homelessness, they've opened that up. They've been a little bit naughty and pretend it hasn't come from homelessness, but it has. They have a strategy called Our Manchester Now, which has come from their age-friendly approach and their homelessness approach. So they do this with all of their services now, they're supposed to. So as part of that, we were given £1 million last month, which we're all co-designing around the table and deciding what we were going to do with it to tackle homelessness in the city. And then I'll finish on the arts, which is, so I'm chair of With One Voice, which Matt took you through before, and going out to Brazil and understanding the power of the arts and people being able to access their voice and use that to affect change, whether it was there for them personally or for them collectively in their city, was a huge insight. I've always understood the power of the arts from a personal perspective and working in international development and understanding people's connection to visualising and vocalising their voice. But our arts group has gone a little bit of a step further, and I'd really like John to talk about one project in particular that we're working on at the moment with Manchester International Festival. But these are some of the examples of the work we've done. So there's the My Manchester project, which was inspired by Cafe Art, so that's somebody who was seeking asylum in the city and has since been kicked out and was co-chairing the group with us, Jack, and somebody from the Booth Centre putting up their photographs that they took around the city together. This is Host, which was a project with a Castlefield Art Gallery and a property developer. That was an artistic intervention in the city, and each of the bronze sculptures that were around a very posh part of Manchester, coming through all of the cracks, each one was connected to an element of the charter so people could find out more about the work we were doing in the city. The top is us coming together as a group, so almost every cultural institution in the city and every homeless service in the city is part of the group, and we're talking about what we should do rather than get around a table regularly as 50-odd people. And at the bottom is Carl Hyde from Underworld, who's working with us on Manchester International Project, which John's going to talk to you a little bit more about, I'm sure about more interesting things as well. So thank you very much.
Afternoon. Yep, as in the bottom left, that's Carl from Underworld. Bringing to Manchester some a work which I think was originally started in Japan, or certainly piloted there. His technique is to very much record people's personal stories and present them in the largest way possible. Appropriately with homelessness, he likes to use cardboard. I suggested he might want to use something more valuable and permanent, like marble, but I don't think that just takes time. And it's not as readily accessible, but by interesting, and you did say you kind of wanted a challenge here. What I quite wanted from that process and the involvement as a whole is how it can open up an alternative duty of care in the associated agencies. Because as Beth said, I'm with ICM, and a lot of their work is very relational. And sorry to cut to co-production, but for me that's the core opening itself. And once that happens, be it the council or an arts institution, it's how the people are valued and then folded into and become a functioning individual in there and a part of systems change, which already is getting very abstract, for which I apologise for. But I do wish to return to the alternative duty of care, because particularly in London, you see the vast amount of resources and sponsorship attached to that, from Santander, the banks over the river. And if you can open up that and open up different pathways for people with lived experience, I think that would be massively useful, because there's a lot to say around giving people a voice, but it's only tacit that you'll listen, and there's no explicit duty to act. So that's what I'd like to focus on. How do you bring people in? Thank you. I'm just going to pass over to Colette to talk about women's voices and ICM.
Women's voices came about around about 18 months ago. It's Phone Change Manchester. It's a Fulfilling Lives project which has been funded over 8 years to the tune of 10 million. They got 2 years in and they started asking a question. The question was, where are all the women? Oops. So we got together, a few of the girls got jobs that had lived experience, and we realised the time was right. At the start of the homelessness chat with the council, I'm probably not going to be your favourite girl here, but I was part of the Women's Direct Access Action Group. The council had committed to working with us, listening and responding to, they let us pick the paint colours. And then we got locked out. But it's all, you shouldn't really do that to women, because when we get mad, we get really mad. And it's, we've sat back for 6 months now, and we've collected all our voice. And what we've done to make that stronger is we've worked on communications materials, including a team for the women with a directory of women's services. But also, we've made our message to the decision makers coherent and exactly the same all the way through. And we are going to be pinning the council down, and we are going to be coming back and asking that they are held to account. Because if you don't have our voices in the middle of that, you're never ever going to find us. Like, we was at, we took part, this, a new homeless up going to be opened up in the city of Manchester. So we was asked to go along and input into that and what would be needed inside the up. So we did, and there was a lot of middle class people in the room, very privileged, never really had an hard knock. And one of the suggestions that came back was that there should be enforced contraception. And it was like, why? And it was like, well, we don't want you breeding. And it's like, oh, okay then. But you'd not figured into, that was like the main thing in the front of the head. And what I wanted to do was open up that conversation and say, how are you going to want make people want to come into your space? What are you going to have inside there that's going to get them women going and wanting to bring them in? And we didn't have a clue. So the next thing we're doing is we're mounting a campaign, and we're hoping to get the City Council to really listen and respond instead of making the decisions first and then giving us the illusion of feeding into that. So hopefully once we've got this voice, Council better watch out and they better start listening to what we need. Thank you.
So we're going to do a Q&A. If Matt wants to get the roaming mic. Do the speakers want to come up here and stand, or are you all right just being where you are? You want to be down with the crowd? Yeah? You all spoke so well. Okay, so I mean, some of the themes that I was pulling out of that David talked a lot about, hiding and shame, which I thought was really interesting. And this particularly, Matt was talking about different cultures' relationship to homelessness, and then we had women's relationship to homelessness as well. And it got me thinking about, obviously I'm working from a working-class background, but particularly around class. I mean, we are in the Tate Modern. We can't ignore where we are in that sense. And how do we, in some ways, address some of the prejudices within British culture around who does art, what is accessible, how is art accessible, and how these spaces themselves are accessible. I don't want to my own experience too much, but I did actually do a performance piece within Somerset House not too long ago, where I borrowed my mum's clothes and walked around the gallery and tried to take some pictures, and they kicked me out. They wouldn't believe I was an artist. So even though I was commissioned, so there's lots of issues around that. So I want to pass it on to the floor if anyone's got any questions for any of the speakers at all. Should I make one up? Oh, there's one there.
I don't know. I don't think any of my questions. So David, thank you for sharing your story, and I look forward to talking to you more. I think one of the goals that we have as an organization is to try to make real for people the issue of homelessness.
We make real for people who are not experiencing homelessness what that experience is. And part of that is understanding the moment before. So your story picked up, right, midway through. And I wonder if you might tell us a little bit more about what led up to that, if you can. It's a lot to ask, I know.
The reason I jumped in halfway is obviously I was only given a 10-minute slot, and we didn't have all day to talk about it. Back in 2011, so this is going back even further, I had my own businesses. I was a chef, very successful. I've cooked for the Queen. I've cooked for every royal family you can think of. And I was really, really good. But with the pressures of business, work, et cetera, you get into alcohol, you get into other substances. And after a while, this took its toll on my body. And I had a stroke back in 2011. After that, I had to walk away from my businesses, so then I lived off my profit for a while. But then I was like, I need to retrain. So I decided to go back to university to do a fine art degree. It was during this time that my addictions, my alcohol content, my health was still deteriorating. I got diagnosed with neurosyphilis, colon cancer, and HIV. Then all this involved, like, you know, several overdose attempts before becoming homeless, and then I took a fatal one in the June of 2013, which killed me. I don't know whether I'm still working. Yeah, still working. And then that caused. Luckily, I got resuscitated, but I then had to go into a mental health facility. When I came out of that, back to my flat, the locks had been changed. So suddenly I was coming out of hospital in still a vulnerable state, but nowhere to go. I couldn't get help from the authorities, government, councils, etc., because I was classed as a student. When in this country, if you're a student, you're not entitled to anything, because they expect you to have family, friends, student loans to pay for everything. I never had that because I was doing it all on my savings. I couldn't work because of my health conditions. So I had to survive. So after 6 months of being in my car, going through all of the cancer treatment, etc., plus I couldn't take any of my meds for my HIV, my health deteriorated so bad that I, like I said, I couldn't see the next day. When that all happened, and Gavin saved my life, he then put me into a night shelter run by the Pillion Trust. And then from then, they then got hold of the Veterans Aid and charities took over. And thankfully, because of those, I'm still here. So that's sort of the gist of it all. Does that help?
You know, many of us are just a paycheck or two away from the experience of homelessness. And I think about that all the time because it's the work that I do. But I think for a lot of people who are insulated from that truth, they go about their business and think, well, that'll never happen to me. But of course, it can happen to anybody at any time. And your story illustrates that. Yeah. Thanks.
I totally agree there, actually, because even though I had my businesses, you know, it was very successful, et cetera, et cetera, I made stupid decisions. You know, I was an addict, I was an alcoholic. You know, these are, you know, stupid decisions now. You know, I look back on my life, but at the time, my mental strength wasn't as what it is now. So, you know, everyone makes bad choices. Does that mean that we have to judge people for it? You know, because one day, you know, someone who's never taken drugs and done any alcohol or anything like that is going to lose their places. There's hundreds of people actually losing it, but we still judge them with the same brush as everyone else. So, you know, we all make bad choices. Let's not judge.
Thank you. Are there any more questions from the floor? I've got one, actually. John Ann, sorry, I've missed your name. Collect. I was really interested in what you were talking about in terms of not the sort of counsellors and things like that doing programmes, but not actually including the very people into the forming the actual programme. And also your point about, I guess we can frame it as in fighting for representation, but not actually including the people you represent in, you know, giving them jobs, essentially, to carry on doing that and to change our system. Could you talk a little bit more about that as well, and, you know, how you think things could change, or, you know, have you had experiences where you might have applied to work in a homeless organisation and didn't get the job or something like that, and, you know?
I'd been knocking around doing volunteering for about 4 years, and it just seemed like I'd go round and round and round in circles, but never with any direction. So I went to shelter, and I was on the core group at first. That didn't really go anywhere because it was just all male voices, and pretty soon, if you're not getting heard, you're going to back off. So that happened. Then I had some health problems of my own, but that really put some fire in me. So I went back, and it was a case of, like, that's mine and I'm going to hang around until I get it. I think if people do start listening to us, they're going to get to it, but I do think they're scared. I think there's a lot of fear around their jobs and the way they do stuff, and it all gets a little bit too close to home because that's what's keeping you the roof above your head. So I can kind of understand why they're frightened, yeah.
Yeah, there's definitely something in what you said last, because there's a kind of symbiotic relationship there, and that ties into something I'm hesitant about saying about who's the principal beneficiary of charitable organisations and services, because you hear a lot about people not wanting to be, you don't want to have people dependent on your service, and you want to build resilience in people. Resilience just allows you to perpetuate abusive systems. So you can build somebody up so you don't have to address the inherent misogyny, racism, and again, basic class divides in society. It does come down to money in the end. It does come down to poverty, whether it's creative or financial. It does seem to shake out one way by and large.
Yeah, absolutely. Does anybody have any comments on that? Person over there, and then we might have to take that as the last one. Yeah.
Okay. Well, last week there was one housing lawyer in the whole of Lambeth working, and Lambeth Law Centre may be completely failing. The reason I know this is because that housing officer was my friend's mum, and my father is the senior solicitor in Lambeth Law Centre. You know, our access to law is completely just draining. It's completely draining. And the only reason I know about this is because of my family connections. And maybe the only reason we're here is because we have a personal connection, or because we work for these, you know, communities. But the wider community just doesn't seem to be doing anything. How do we include them?
It's a tough... I mean, as a activist, I mean, when I was doing Marie Claim Brixton, that was one of the tasks, and particularly as a feminist activist and as a black feminist activist, to communicate. Sometimes you can end up in a little bubble of people who know stuff, and then trying to communicate that to people who are affected by it, who know the issues and everything like that, but they don't want to engage with you for whatever reason. Sometimes, frankly, they don't understand what you're saying. Sometimes they're just not interested. And also, I feel like the times that when people do their activism is something that I'm always trying to challenge, because if you're picking up your kids from school and then you're going to work, you're not going to get to a meeting at 5 o'clock. You're going to have a meeting at 8 o'clock or on a Saturday morning. And I think it's things like that. Is there tea? Is there lunches provided that will bring people in? Because then they think, oh yeah, you know, actually I can go to that now. I've got a creche to put the kids in. These are things that I think people need to consider more when they're actually having open conversations and stuff like that. Is it accessible, essentially? But I think what you're saying is absolutely right, and I think that's something that, you know, people can address. I think we'll take this as the last comment, and then we'll get on to that one. Yeah. Go to that one.
Thanks. I hope this doesn't go up and down. I'll just I'll see what happens. So this slide was the last one deliberately. So I think one answer to that is look at different mediums and different ways of engaging people. Don't try and talk to the same audience. So the one on the bottom left, that's in the most prestigious banking district in Manchester. And the people who came on that tour neither engaged in homelessness or particularly social justice issues, and all came up to us at the end of the tour and said, what can I do? And the what can you do is involved in the charter and the partnership. So it doesn't matter whether you have money, a bit of spare time, or whether you have a position or a position of influence, or you have a voice and an experience you want to put forward. There's a space for that. And if there isn't, make it. Like Colette was saying, like the Women's Direct Access went totally wrong, but make it into something else. So that's now a Women's Voices group, right? So you have, as long as co-production is involved in there, then that has the space to be shaped by the people that are involved. But they need a direction to be pointed in. Everybody needs a direction. The problem we have at the moment in Manchester is everybody wants to get involved, and it's the direction to funnel people in rather than them just giving to people on the streets and perpetuating people's crisis, if that's you know what you agree with. The Manchester International Festival is another example. That happens every 2 years, and there are hundreds of thousands of people who come to the city because of that, and they'll engage with the issue via the arts and via a bridge. So it's finding those bridges, whether it's the arts or whether it's a human being and a story or whatever it might be, it's finding those and then taking people across them to one another. And I think, as Billy said, just giving people an opportunity to listen. And as John said, then an opportunity to act. Yeah. It's those two things, I think.
David wanted to come in on a point here.
I also reckon that we need to think outside the box a bit more. Instead of standing on a soapbox, getting angry and shouting and protesting, I think if we give something beautiful and like stuff like what Cafe Art do, you know, where you're thinking outside the box, you're not just doing what they think. Like, if you get angry and shout all the time, no one's going to listen. So it becomes void, you know. But if you give something beautiful, you know, like artwork or photography or fashion, you know, and think it and demonstrate in a completely different way, more people listen. And it's true, it's working.
I absolutely agree with that. I'd like to bring in Matt. I was really interested in what you were talking about with Brazil and the thing about art as a human right. And what do you think it is? Do you think it's a culturally about how people interact with the art might be different there?
I think they just talk about arts as being in the UN Charter of Human Rights. It's enshrined, it's been there for a while. We as human beings everywhere are creative people. It's not a privilege, you know. It's something that we're born with. All the interactions that we have with tiny children are artistic. You know, you dance around and paint and do all these things. Suddenly that's sucked out partly because of the education system. But we need to remind ourselves that art is in everyone, creativity is in everyone. And it's like that jigsaw approach, that if we regard art as something that is not hierarchically different, but just on the table at least, then we can solve social issues much more effectively.
Absolutely, thank you. We'll have one last point, and then I'm going to bring James up.
Hello, the last speaker I was going to ask a question to was, you said at the beginning of the presentation that 1/3 of homeless art produced is in UK. Is there even with that fact, why is there such a big disproportion with homelessness, even though we had 1/3 of the world production of art? Is there a particular imbalance going on there or what?
Thanks. Well, there are various theories. I think one is money. We're in a very privileged place in the UK that there is funding for the arts. Now, you could argue that funding is tiny compared to like the Ministry of Defence or housing or something like that. But the fact of the matter is there are 2,000 trusts and foundations. You go to somewhere like Japan, a very rich country, and not one of those six arts projects gets any money for any staff at all. All of those people, the dance company, that guy is a dancer, a gardener in his spare time, and he does it because it's important. So I think the reason why there's so much rich work in this country is partly because of funding.
Thank you. Okay, I'm going to we're going to start on the next round of speakers now. So I'd like to introduce James Murray, who's the Deputy Mayor of Housing and Residential Development. James joined the Mayor's office in 2016 as Deputy Mayor for Housing and Residential Development. Coming from Islington Council, where he held the position of Executive Member for Housing and Development for 6 years, Jane will talk about the GLA, which is the Greater London Authority policy, and citywide attempts to address the housing crisis. Thank you, James. Can we get the first slide from the homeless side to the back now?
I can find it. I just take the mic. Just to say, on breaks, we will be breaking at 2. We'll also be bringing in sandwiches, refreshments into this space, which you're all welcome to. So just to make you all aware of that. So I have 2 more speakers, another round of questions, and then a break at 2. We'll be starting again at 2:30, but that's a point to if you want to go check out some of the other things as well. Yeah, absolutely, that's fine. So we'll have refreshments here at 2.
Well, thank you very much for inviting me along here today. And thank you all for staying around if you're getting hungry or thirsty and want to pop out. But thanks for staying to hear what I want to add to the debate today. And I think when I was thinking about what to focus on in what I'm speaking about today, I was starting from the point of view of what the headline today is, State of the Nation. And for me, the part of the nation which I'm working for and representing is London. And when we're talking about homelessness and rough sleeping, it is clearly a problem across the country, but in London it is particularly acute. And we do have specific problems in London with homelessness and rough sleeping in particular. And I went to an event recently where Cardboard Citizens had done a production of Cathy Come Home, a modernized version of it, 50 years on, 50 years after Cathy Come Home was first broadcast. And it was a new interpretation of the original show, and it was at the National Theatre. And that was a really powerful moment to reflect on what's changed, you know, what's better now than 50 years ago, but also to reflect on the fact there are still huge challenges. And, you know, being honest, things have gotten worse in the last few years. I'm just conscious is this the right microphone's working?
Yeah.
You know, when you think about what happened 50 years ago and you compare it with now, clearly in terms of a safety net, there have been really big advances. But the kind of pressure that people are facing now in some ways is just as acute. And there are new pressures rising. And as I say, in the last few years, things have gotten worse. And the mayor is very clear about this when he talks about his reaction to homelessness and rough sleeping in London, which is to be really upfront about it and say that it shames our city. You know, we're in London, where we've got huge growth, huge wealth, and huge ability, and people from around the world making it the greatest city in the world. But the fact that homelessness and rough sleeping has risen so much in recent years is a shame on our city, and it's a call to action. We have a moral duty to respond. And I think the other thing that is important to me about shows like the Cathy Come Home performance I saw, and a lot of the stuff which is here today, is to really explain to Londoners what homelessness means in its broadest sense. Because quite often when you're talking to Londoners on the street, homelessness is equivalent to rough sleeping in their mind until you start talking about the broader impact of homelessness in society. And I think having that discussion with Londoners so that people realise that homelessness goes well beyond rough sleeping. Rough sleeping in one way is the sharpest end of homelessness, but the fact that homelessness is actually much broader problem right across London and beyond, I think is really important in terms of public awareness. You know, there was a stat by Shelter, the housing charity they came out with last year, where they said that 1 in 50 Londoners at the moment is homeless. And that's quite a challenging stat. You know, that really does get your attention, because when you start thinking, firstly, it's a lot of people, 1 in 50, but it really makes people confront what homelessness means, because it's not just rough sleeping, it's also people who are hidden homeless, sofa surfing, people who are in temporary accommodation because they're homeless and councils have put them in private rented sector accommodation which is insecure and possibly away from their support networks. And I think having that broader understanding of homelessness is a really crucial part to the public debate. You know, although last year there were 8,000 people identified sleeping rough on the streets of London, there are 50,000 households in temporary accommodations, so 50,000 households in London who are homeless and who councils have got placed in private sector accommodation. But that's 50,000 households who can't call this home somewhere secure where they can be confident that they can stay in the long run. And I think, you know, that's a real hidden part of the argument, a real hidden part of the public awareness about this, because the level of disruption it causes for homeless families, particularly if they're away from their support networks, When people don't have their friends and family nearby to look after kids, when kids have to move from school to school, when kids sometimes don't even have space at home to do their homework. You know, that's a really huge impact that homelessness is having, and it's sometimes more hidden from public sight than rough sleeping or street population, but I think it's really essential that we raise public awareness around that. Having said that, rough sleeping clearly is the sharpest end of the housing crisis more broadly, and although a lot of the reasons why people end up sleeping rough might be connected to broader reasons of homelessness, there are usually more associations with particular individuals' histories of why they end up rough sleeping. You know, almost half of the people sleeping rough on the streets of London have a mental health support need. We have to recognise that people need support and intervention to help them off the streets. It's not an easy solution, it's not an easy problem to tackle, but it's one that means we need to recognise the different reasons why people end up sleeping rough, and therefore the different responses people need to help them off the streets. So what are we doing about it? Well, the mayor has said that tackling rough sleeping in the first instance is a huge priority for him. As I say, it is a shame on our city to walk along the streets and see people being forced to sleep rough. And so he set up a No Nights Sleeping Rough group, which he launched in the first few months in office. And this brings together the key councils in London who cover areas where the greatest number of rough sleepers are, key people in the homelessness sector and charities who do great work helping people off the streets, and central government to make sure that we're using any access to resources and funds which might be on offer from central government. And this No Night Sleeping Rough Task Force has come together in the first few months, and we put in a bid, in fact, to central government for extra money for homelessness and rough sleeping services. And we got £4.2 million towards the end of last year, which is a good boost because the existing money we get is about £8.5 million a year. So the extra £4.2 million is a real boost to help us increase services which are really tailored. And I think if you look at what we're spending that money on, for instance, a large amount of that money is going on a particular program helping entrenched rough sleepers, making sure that we have the right response to people who, for whatever reason, haven't been helped out so far and have spent a long time on the streets. The other part of the work that we're doing through the Mayor's Office is working with councils across London because, as I said earlier on when I was introducing what I'm saying today, there is this problem of hidden homelessness. There are 50,000 households who are in temporary accommodation across London. And what happens is that councils end up competing against each other to get that accommodation for homeless households. So each council in London, the 32 boroughs, they have homeless households who they need to find accommodation for. Because the rents are going up so much in London and so high, they end up competing against each other and outbidding each other historically, as is what's been happening. And that just means that you're not helping anyone, really, apart from the landlord in that case, who's getting a greater rental return. But actually, in terms of councils and public money and getting the right outcome for the households involved, we need to coordinate that together. And so that's why, since we took office last year, we've coordinated a group of councils across London to say, look, this is in no one's interest for councils to be bidding against each other to find that temporary accommodation. We need to find a way forward. And that's work that we've put money into. The councils are doing some work, and we're getting government in the picture as well to make sure we can move beyond the situation which everyone agrees is not right. And I'll just wrap up by saying, you know, the other part of it, there's clearly work we're doing at the Mayor's Office with all the homelessness charities and councils. But the other part of this that strikes me as being really important is the desire of Londoners themselves to get involved, to volunteer, to put their time, their money, and their resources, their effort, into doing something about homelessness and rough sleeping. And I'm sorry if I missed it being spoken about earlier on, but I think we touched on the idea about how do people channel their energy and channel their enthusiasm to do something about this, you know, avoiding just necessarily giving money to people on the streets, which may not be productive. And what really struck me is that when we had, for instance, the emergency shelter open over the very cold period over the winter, a lot of Londoners got in touch with us saying, what can I do to help? You know, how can I help this? How can I make sure that I'm giving my time and my money to the right outcome here? And so I think we really need to focus as part of the solution, not just on working with councils and charities and third sector, but also with Londoners themselves to make a real difference. And with everything in the housing crisis, there's no quick solution. You know, it'll take years to turn things round. But I think if we start from that premise of working together, getting the right resources, and good Londoners coming together, we have a chance of making a difference. Thank you.
We're going to take Q&A. We're going to get Charlotte and then Paul to both of you together. So thank you. Thank you, James. We'll be open for questions after we have our next speakers, which are Charlotte Kramer and Scarlett Montanaro. Charlie and Scarlett are the founders and directors of Crack and Cider, an organisation where people can buy essential items for the homeless, which are then delivered to those in need. The organisation has branches in London and San Francisco, and they were chosen as Nesta New Radicals in 2016.
Thanks very much. Hi everyone, and thank you all for coming. I think this is going to be the perfect segue on from what James just touched on, which is around this idea that although we don't want to be giving cash on the streets, we all want to be doing something productive to help. So I'm going to start by firstly telling you a little bit about Crack and Cider, and then Scarlett's going to give you something that hopefully we can all take away today and actually take some action to the streets and do something positive. So I'm Charlotte Kramer.
I'm Scarlett Montanaro.
And we're the co-founders of Crack and Cider. We came up with Crack and Cider when about 2 years ago when we were in Berlin. And this homeless man approached us and asked us for some spare change on the street, and we kind of brushed him off and said no and looked the other way, and we walked away and went to get this coffee. And we ended up spending probably €7 on this coffee and having this conversation about how horrible that was, that we'd brushed this man off who only wanted a couple of euros, and then we'd gone and, without even thinking about it, spent a ridiculous amount of money on some warm caffeine. And we started discussing, like, why was this the case? Why were we not giving money where we wanted to or where we felt guilty? And what could we do about it? That's why. Coffee. And this was the actual coffee that we had in Berlin. So I was so excited to find this photo. We started discussing why was it that we felt guilty. We felt a strong sense of empathy for this person and many other people that we walked past every single day, but we weren't doing anything to help. And this interaction was being played out across the world. We came back to London and spoke to our friends and family, and also people who were experiencing homelessness at the time. And everyone reiterated the same message. We weren't giving money on the street because we were worried it would be spent on crack and cider. And that's obviously where the name came from. And we wondered, like, why were we feeling this way? What had instilled in our minds this idea that we shouldn't be giving money on the street? Why were we stopping people from helping? And then when we looked to the media that was surrounding the issue, it became really clear. We were actually being told not to help. And not only were we being told not to help, but we're not even given an adequate solution. And like James just said, you know, people are saying, how can I help? How can I help? How can I help? You're telling me not to give cash on the streets. And that was something that has even been iterated a couple of times this afternoon. But we weren't given another resource or another way to, like, show our compassion and show that we care. And so we really approached this believing that people do care. We're not horrible, we're not assholes because we didn't give money on the street. It's just that we weren't given an adequate solution and an adequate means to show that we do care. And on top of that, and on top of the idea that we're not giving money on the streets because we worry it'll be spent on drugs and alcohol, there was also at the time an increased skepticism around giving to big charitable organizations. And ultimately, it's the same problem. In both scenarios, we don't know where our money is being spent. And we started discussing, like, it's quite a strange transaction to be asked to give money and not know what it's being spent on. If you think about the psychology of money and it being in its nature transactory, it's very strange to be asked to give it without knowing exactly where it's going. And that's exactly what was happening with either being asked to give money on the streets or giving to a big charitable organization, where sometimes you worry it will be spent on their fancy buildings in London than maybe on the people that they promised to serve. On top of that, there was one way bigger problem that we noticed. With communications like this and the overarching message in the media, and it was ultimately that we were dehumanizing people who were experiencing homelessness. We were identifying them purely by their living situation. We're not talking about their identity or their hopes, their dreams, what they care about, what they do in the day, their favorite meals. We're talking about just their living situation. And by doing so, it creates this massive divide of us and them. And we fundamentally believe, and this has definitely come out from the time that we've spent speaking to people who have experienced homelessness and looking at these communications and speaking to people who work in the sector, but this gap is only getting wider with the conversations that are perpetuated by communications like that. And so we took a step back and thought, how can we create the most simple and transparent model for charitable giving that will enable people who do care to show that they care? And with that, we launched Crack and Cider. And Crack and Cider is simply an e-commerce platform where you can buy essential items which we distribute to homeless people. And to your point, sorry, I can't remember your name, but you mentioned earlier like working with the people who you're serving. We went to a bunch of shelters when we first started this and identified the five most essential products that people said that they needed who were living in shelters, sleeping on the street. Go onto the online shop, pick your items, purchase them, and then we'll send those to our distribution partners, which are 13 different shelters and soup kitchens across the capital. And I think it was probably just the simplicity of it and this need and this yearning for a really simple way to show that you care, which enabled journalists to like resonate with our message and communicate to their audiences. And a couple of girls in the audience helped us with the PR, so thank you. And I think off the back of that, it really like enabled people to show and prove their generosity and show that they care. And that led us to be able to sell over 7,000 essential items, which we've distributed just in London. And then a year later, after our London launch, we just launched in San Francisco, which also has an extremely bad issue around homelessness. And to date, we've sold over $100,000 worth of stock and been able to distribute that in both London and San Francisco. And I think the most amazing thing is that the average donation in London has been £28. And I'm sure that it's very rare that someone will hand over £28 on the street, but I think the simplicity of this model has proven that people are willing to be generous and they do want to like give their money to people who they believe should be the recipient of it. So, sorry, Lex.
So this $100,000 figure is all just a result of that one guy back in Berlin asking for some spare change. And that's something that obviously we find amazing, but we also understand that $100,000 is a bit of a drop in the ocean. But we want the momentum that he's created to keep going and go bigger and wider than any of the work that we even do, because we know that it's not enough. We provide a very real and immediate need and fulfill that need of people trying to survive a harsh winter on the streets, but it's something that all of us here can do is help the psychological well-being of homeless people. So it's not new and it may not be innovative, but there's something that we want to spread today, which is simply human connection. And I learned something on my journey. I've met some amazing, amazing people. And this guy is called Faris. And he taught me something that's really stayed with me, which was that actually one of the biggest threats to homeless people is us, the general public. He used to sell The Big Issue. He used to be homeless, and he's managed to work his way out of his poverty. And he has now founded a charity that gives back to other homeless people. So he's strong, he's kind, he's compassionate, he's intelligent. But the sad thing is that none of that mattered when he was homeless. He tells me of a time when he was bedding down in a shop doorway, trying to get some sleep, and without warning, the shopkeeper comes out and hoses him down and drenches him from head to toe. He tells me of another time that's completely separate, when he was sleeping on the street, and some drunk people walked past him and spilt alcohol on his shoes and set his shoelaces on fire. I mean, the mind boggles at what people are capable of, and he shouldn't obviously never be treated this way, but it isn't just the physical harm, it's the psychological damage that can be as harmful. And it's something that we can all actively fight against and all should be actively fighting against. Because this us versus them rhetoric is as dangerous as it is dehumanizing. And I'm sure none of you here today are going to be the sort of people that are going to go outside and try and physically harm people, but I'm sure we are all in some way guilty of contributing to the isolation and the alienation. Because one of the biggest things that homeless people say they feel is invisible. And Luckily, there's an easy fix, and it's something that each and every one of us can do the second we step outside of this door today. And that's simple acts of kindness. And I can already feel there's this paradigm shift happening already towards this sort of behaviour. And it's so amazing to hear, because given what we do with Crack and Cider, my friends will call me up or text me or tell me about things that they've been doing and these interactions that they've had on the streets. And, for example, a friend over there, actually, said the other day that she was walking past a homeless person that was shivering, and she gave him the scarf from around her neck. And another friend of mine goes and he deliberately cooks way too much dinner when he's at home cooking at night. And he packs it all up while it's still hot and goes and feeds it to the people in his area. And one guy said, mate, sit down with me. I haven't had a meal with somebody for months. And they did, and they sat and they exchanged names and they exchanged stories. And I've got loads of examples like this, but it's so amazing, because what I see is my friends lighting up with this sense of joy and fulfillment that I don't see in them that often. And it's because they're getting as much out of that situation and that interaction as the homeless person is, because it's truly a mutually beneficial thing. Because if we take a look again at this us versus them, we're spending our days rushing through our lives, unable to make any real meaningful human connections, and feeling more isolated than we ever have before. And that's down to, you know, spending our lives in digital replicas of human interaction. But they, over there, have got time to reflect and are looking at us as we walk past, offering a completely different perspective on society as we may see it. And, time. So, my point was something. It's gone. Anyway, yes. So, yeah, they over there have got lives and stories and names, and what if we just ignored all this us versus them stuff and we just stopped for a minute and talked, said hi, offered a coffee and a moment of our time? Because I really believe that that could be something that would have an impact on both of our days and, over time, both of our lives. Because it's this shared human connection that will eventually bridge this huge gap between us and them. And it's bridging that gap that's going to make the biggest difference in our society. But I'll leave you with this. We did a study on what home means to people. And we asked people both with and without a home. And the resounding answer was that home is a feeling. And one of our favourite responses, I'll read for you now, was, I truly don't feel at home anywhere, though I guess right now it's in the doorway of St. Paul's Cathedral where I usually sleep. I can feel at home in unfamiliar places if in the right company. People that make me feel love, peace, and acceptance can make anywhere feel like home. So we truly believe that although we may not be able to offer the 7,000 rough sleepers in London a home, we can help them to feel at home. And all it takes is a little love, peace, and acceptance. Thank you.
Can I bring James back up here as well for questions? Thank you. That was really, I found that really interesting, considering we were just talking about accessibility in terms of how people can actually take action and get involved if they want to. So some of the things that we were talking about, or both of you were talking about, were things around mental health, how, you know, home is more than just a roof over your head, actually. It's somewhere of security in terms of landlords. And it also got me thinking about, when we're talking about funding, and you guys providing things when you can, is this how we think about homelessness and what it is, but and how do we then address it? Sometimes we get into a thing where we end up just providing solutions to, you know, when someone's ill, you give them a pill or something like that, but we don't actually start addressing how that person ended up in that situation in the first place. And I think, it brings us into the thoughts around how society dehumanises people and makes people feel ashamed for asking for help before they even get to that point. I think Dave touched upon that. So I think these things go really deep. I'm not going to go into the patriarchy. I'm a feminist. I'm not going to go there. But if you want to talk to me about it later, I will. So has anybody got any questions? At the back there, we've got a question there.
Can you define homeliness?
Homeliness?
Y'all were speaking so long. I was listening to y'all. Can you define homeliness? Yeah, homelessness.
Okay. So actually, when we first started out, as I can't remember who it was earlier said, but we thought that homelessness meant rough sleeping, and we saw them as two pieces of the same pot. And largely, we realised the reason why that was is because oftentimes there'll be charitable organisations who are asking for funds for the homeless, but they're using the image of the rough sleeper to guilt trip you into giving money to helping the homeless, which might not necessarily be rough sleeping. And so when we spoke to a lot of people who were experiencing homelessness, we realized that there was kind of this hierarchy of homelessness. And there are people who come in and out of the situation for very different reasons and at different times and for different lengths of time. And so homelessness is a very complex symptom. And I think that's probably the key point, that it's purely a symptom rather than the issue itself.
No, because there are two types of homeless people on the streets. One who is homeless because he's lost his job and house and he's not being helped. And there are others who take drugs because of mental issues and who take drink and causes problems on the streets. So people, when they talk, they don't define. These people don't get help. These people get help. And when these people don't get help, they're going to join this group of people will exceed the number of what they got now. So y'all should try to define the people that homelessness, some are on the street because they lost their job, they lost their homes. But no government or no organization is helping those kind of people. I was on the streets for 18 months, right? I was not a drunkard. I was not an addict. I never smoked. But still, I was treated and I was branded by that name. So people and organizations should define that there are certain people who are mentally ill and they need those things for them to survive, but they should be treated well, and when they come out, not be left restrained. People come out of rehab. Last week, a boy came out of rehab not in a week's time, and he started drinking. When I asked him, why are you drinking? You just come out of rehab. He says, I come back, I'm on the streets, I joined the same group, so naturally after a week's time, I started drinking. So when these people come out, the society and the organization don't have a plan for these kind of people who come out to see that they have a place, they have something to do that will divert their mind so that they don't go back in the rehab. That's my message to y'all, to the organizers.
Hello, yeah. I was going to ask, like the UK has the longest working hours in Europe, so people under a lot of pressure financially and all that as well. And I think this, another speaker said that a lot of people are two paychecks away from being homeless themselves. So, I was going to ask you, people who are walking by potentially could be homeless themselves in a couple of weeks. So, In that mix of everything, how do you get through the barrier of people wanting to help? Because obviously, in your website, you said the average donation was £28, which is quite a lot of money. So there is a desire for people to help, but people are under such financial pressure, working long hours. I don't know how you break through that glass ceiling. Have you any ideas on that?
So you mean as a member of the general public who's working and under financial
The people who are donating money.
Of course. I mean, that is a huge issue, and we completely understand that. But given what we've said today, I think it's as much about talking and giving time and offering, you know, a coffee and a chat as it is about donating money. So you can always do something with just half an hour if you have it. So, and yeah.
I think you know, your point is right to make about people walking along the street and themselves could be facing issues around homelessness themselves without too much changing in their life. And I think the gentleman at the back who gave his sort of personal reflection on the situation as well goes back to a point that I sort of started making when I was speaking earlier about the diversity of different people in different situations under this one term homeless. You know, you have people who, as we were discussing earlier, councils have a responsibility to house because they are homeless, it's homeless families and so on. You have people who are hidden homeless, you know, particularly young people who councils are not able to help, but who are, you know, sofa surfing, don't have a fixed address, find it very difficult to therefore get on in life. And then you have people who are rough sleeping. At the same time, a lot of the street population are not necessarily rough sleepers. So it's a more complicated issue than that. And I think that's why directing people's energy and their efforts, or their donations, resources, whatever, is quite complicated, because the issue itself is complicated. You know, if we're thinking at City Hall about how to help people who are rough sleeping, what's really important to us is to work out the different groups of people who you need to help. Because some people might spend one or two nights on the street rough sleeping, and there's a particular way you help them, intervene quickly, get them off the street, and get them back into hopefully stable accommodation. Some people, it's much harder to help in the first instance, and they end up becoming more entrenched rough sleeping, need very particular sort of support services and interventions to help them off. So it's not, there isn't, even from a kind of government point of view, there isn't a straightforward way or a one-size-fits-all approach, rather, to helping everyone. But what it does mean is that we need to work right across London. Well, we're working in sort of in government terms to make sure we've got that range of different responses, but also to help Londoners give their different donations, or whether it's time or money, in a way that helps people across the board. Because there isn't a single way that people can donate time or money which will help everyone. We need to make sure we have the different ways people can give their time and money to help people in all those different situations.
Thank you.
How will you capture the number of young people sofa surfing in your workload? How will you capture the number of young people sofa surfing in your workload?
Sofa surfing.
Yes.
So about sofa surfing with young people, how do we?
Who are rough sleeping, seamless transition there, very people who are young and
anniversary, quite recently,
I'm supposed to be neutral, sorry. bring up on that point, we've got a question over there, which I'll come to in a second, is because I live in Brixton Housing Co-op. I've literally just got accommodation. I've been in it for a year, actually. And Brixton Housing Co-op started in 1977. And I don't know if those of you familiar, Brixton, Railton Road, used to be called the front line of squatting. And they all started as squats. And now, thankfully, you know, generations later, I was able to be housed within it. And I'm just wanting to know, is City Hall thinking about supporting to help people get housing co-ops again? Is there funds happening or, you know?
So the approach that we take in City Hall is to say what London needs, and forgive me if this just sounds a bit obvious, but it needs more homes of all sorts, of all types. There isn't one particular sort of home that we need. We need everything. You know, we need homes which are built for sale, homes for rent. We need homes built by home builders, as well as smaller co-ops and so on, and community-led housing. We need everyone to be building homes across London. And one of the things the mayor is really keen to support is community-led housing. And one of the issues that we find with community-led housing so far is that sometimes the expertise and the resource isn't there amongst the groups who want to do it. So you have people come together and they know they want to be involved in community-led housing and they want to build homes using that model, which is great, but they might not know how to access funding or how to get planning advice or, you know, all of the technical stuff you need to get building. So what we set up in the budget is a new fund to serve a community-led housing hub. And the idea about this, we haven't been able to go into individual projects, the idea of this hub is more about increasing skills and capacity amongst community-led housing groups. So making sure that if you have a group of people coming together and want to build new housing on a cooperative basis or other community-led housing structures, they can get skilled up, they can get access to the resources they need, and they can take that project forward.
Thank you. We had a question at the back there. There's a person with a black t-shirt on, I think. Thank you.
Hi, everybody, and thank you to all the speakers this morning. It's the question that the young man just asked about young people being missed, not counted, not noticed, which it's so very upsetting. But the thing that really drives me mad is that we're at the same time as having these conversations facing 18 to 22-year-olds not being eligible for housing benefit anymore. And of course there'll be exceptions, but we all know what that means. It means thresholds, it means having to prove your need, your vulnerability. So I feel really emotional about it because all of us here want to do the right thing and are trying to chip away in our little bits. But we are all the time fighting against a government that every week seems to come up with another policy to show they just don't care.
Thank you. And also that same government is kind of possibly on its way to attacking housing cooperatives. I was at my housing meeting recently and we were just informed that there's some talk of legislation about putting a cap on how much you can earn if you live in a housing co-op. So essentially we will be losing those skills which we are supposed to be keeping. So that's just something to be aware of if you're in a housing co-op. Have we got any other questions or comments? Should we go back and I'll come back to you? There's at the back there. And then we'll have that, and then you'll be the last
Hey. One. It's really inspiring to hear the story behind Crack and Cider. I'd love to know what's next.
Well, we've obviously launched in San Francisco for
in our first 12 months, which was really, really exciting. And we've had a lot of interest from other cities around the world who want to adopt the same model. So we're sort of working towards this. We're calling it an open source toolkit, yet to understand really what that means, but it sounds good. But yeah, so we've got sort of setting up teams in different cities, hopefully one in Bristol coming up this winter and one in New York. So that's the plan. I mean, we also want to try and figure out a way that we can move it beyond just giving jackets and coats and perhaps leading towards offering workshops or training or in some way. So yeah, we're kind of feeling our way through it. And to be honest, actually, we both have full-time jobs. We do this completely voluntary on the side in our evenings and weekends. So the planning bit is taking a back seat and we're making it up as we go along, really. So yeah, that's our goals and that's what we're working towards at the moment.
We're going to have two, three last questions. Maybe we should just start bringing in the sandwiches and things and a bit, because we might run over by about 5 minutes, I think. So we've got two short questions here, and then we'll finish over there. If that's okay? Yeah. Okay.
What was your biggest challenge when you started this campaign?
What was the biggest challenge starting the campaign?
Our biggest challenge is quite a boring one, and it was around logistics, because we didn't expect to sell 7,000 items, and you have no idea what 5,000 jackets looks like until you need to find somewhere to put them, and then find somewhere to deliver them and the people to accept them. And so it was quite a boring logistical challenge of how do we get the stock from the wholesalers to into the hands of the people who need it the most. And that meant thinking about things like products being sold on, ensuring that people, that if we go to one shelter, every single guest of that shelter is getting a jacket, because we never wanted a situation where someone has to choose who gets an item. So there were a lot of like just logistical questions that we had to think about once we had the stock, and how do we get it into the hands of the people that need it.
Can I just add to that? Yeah. I mean, that was an amazing challenge to have, because that meant that we'd already done so much leading up to that point that we were struggling to find stock. So I think a lot of the challenges that we thought we were going to face, actually we didn't. We were worried that they weren't going to trust a new brand and this new model. The name. Yeah, I mean, the first few bits of big press that we got were all around our name and is it offensive, is it not? And we spent the first 2 weeks thinking, we are public enemy number one, we're never going to work in this town again. But it turned out fine, and actually then we ended up with this amazing challenge on our hands that we didn't know where to put the stuff, so we were really blown away by the generosity of the British public.
Do you want to touch on bureaucracy?
Bureaucracy.
Logistics.
In the last 30 seconds, I'll just address... I think, you know, what we need to do is make sure that when we're putting limited resources that we have access to at City Hall, it's being spent well. And that's a fundamental principle, obviously, of government across the board. But I think one of the really exciting things we've been doing in recent months is putting together these bids I mentioned. So when I was speaking earlier, I was talking about the No Night Sleeping Rough task force, the group that we set up, and about this task force coming together to say, right, if we can access more money, how is the absolute best targeted way we could use this? And I mentioned briefly, you know, one of the ways to do it is through this, it's called a social impact bond, and it's a way of targeting the money at helping specifically entrenched rough sleepers, making sure that money is really going to help people off the streets who, for whatever reason, haven't been helped by any other services over a number of months or years. So I think from our point of view, my response to the big question of bureaucracy, you know, is about making sure that in the limited resources we have, we are working with everyone to make sure we're targeting them in exactly the right way to help as many people as possible.
Thank you. We've got two last questions. You wanted to ask a question?
Who was it, sorry?
Yeah, these are the last two, and we'll be coming back at 2:30.
Why is there some young people under under the age of 18 who are homeless are turned away by the social service?
Why are young people under the age of 18 turned away by social services?
You get all the good questions.
Yeah. I mean, That's a really, it's a really challenging question, and it's a really, it's one that, you know, I think when we're talking about people who are homeless across the board, there is something particular about young people, you know, particularly if they're under the age of 18, but even young people slightly over 18, facing homelessness, which is particularly difficult, because the reason why a lot of young people might be facing homelessness when they're young is because they haven't got the support networks, family and so on, to rely on, and they are people who we should be looking out for. I mean, the mayor was critical about the 18 to 21 issue, which was mentioned by the audience member at the back. He was asked at mayor's question time recently about it and set out his position on that. And I think, you know, our response is to make sure that we're firstly lobbying in the appropriate way to say actually that change for 18 to 21 year olds is counterproductive, but also to make sure we're doing everything we can in the meanwhile, both from City Hall, but also working with right organisations who are out there on the front line, who have the connections to young people who need help, making sure we're giving them all of the support that we can.
Thank you. I just want to add to that slightly as well, because I do a lot of work with Stonewall Housing as an LGBT person, and a lot of the young people under 18 are LGBT and have been kicked out of their homes for that. And I think this goes back again to what you guys from Manchester were saying about how sometimes the people who are making the decisions are not aware of what other people's lives are like, and so people assume that if you're under 18 then you will have somewhere to go, but a lot of people don't have anywhere to go. Should we just finish over here, please, and then we'll have our teas and coffees and sandwiches.
This is for the gentleman. How are you going to be engaging in a meaningful way with the people of lived experience from your borough?
That's a really good question. How do we make sure that I, working at City Hall, don't just end up sitting there in City Hall trying to work out policies on our own? And our kind of approach under Sadiq has been to make sure that in housing generally, including homelessness and rough sleeping, we're working outside of City Hall as well as using the resources within the building. So trying to build those alliances, trying to build the coalition, trying to get everyone in who has a stake, has a role to play, to make sure that we understand the problem better and that we come up with better solutions by virtue of having engaged with people. So I'm spending my time, as well as in City Hall, going out, seeing homelessness and rough sleeping projects, seeing people working in some of the shelters and services on the front line to understand what is the problem here? You know, what the great work you're doing, what could we do to help? You know, where would our resources be best spent? And I very much am of the view that this is never going to be solved by people sat in a government building coming up with plans in a closed room. You know, we're going to start to solve this by going out there, by understanding the problem better, by engaging with on the front line with service providers and people they're helping, and by working with this broad coalition of people who have a role to play, which is from City Hall and government, but also from charities, third sector, and Londoners themselves. And it's only by that working together that we'll start to make a difference.
Because what I'm trying to get at is, as my friend John here, it's one of his best, and he says, you might arrive in an Audi, he arrives with wet shoes. So in other words, you're getting a pay packet for this. We're coming on public transport for our love and what we want to change. So what are you going to give us for helping you do your job?
You save the best question till last, don't you? Well, I mean, as I say, what I can offer, what I can guarantee, is that I am not going to take this job and go and haul myself away at City Hall and try and come up with clever ideas just from there, because I don't believe that's how you solve problems. I don't believe that's how you come up with the right responses. I don't believe that's how you come up with the right solutions. And I don't believe that's how you get things done. I think you get things done by going out there, by meeting people who are affected, by talking to all the different players who have a part to play. And as I say, it's only by that working together that we can hope to make a difference. I'm not going to talk about particular jobs at City Hall. What I'm talking about is the way that we are engaging with people across London in responding to homelessness and rough sleeping, and also everything on the housing agenda. You know, we're not going to say we at City Hall can come up with all the solutions ourselves. We know that we have to work with everyone across London to work out what the best thing to do is.
Matt, do you want to...
Yeah, absolutely. Thank you all for that first session. Just to say that we are starting two things outside. First will be a performance of our installation Exchanged, where we've been gathering objects and stories from around the country. These are some amazing objects, and these stories will be told individually by formerly homeless actors. That's been a six-month process through which we've been gathering that exhibition out there. So that's happening on the hour, so that's happening now. We all are also having catering in here as well, so refreshments. So please do help yourself if you'd like those. We're also having a music performance from the West London Day Centre and the Academy at St Martin in the Fields over the other side of the floor as well. And later on, at 4:30, please make sure you stay for the Choir with No Name performance to round off the day. But thank you all for that amazing first session. Thank you to the speakers and Shardy. Cheers.